Welcome to the Performing Arts Series, brought to you by the Kennedy Center and the Prince William Network. I'm Kim Kokich, your moderator for today's program with ballerina Suzanne Farrell and Masters of the 20th Century Ballet. It's an honor to welcome Miss Farrell. Those of us who were lucky enough to see productions of the New York City Ballet when she danced with them can tell you she was considered very cool by both fans and critics. In fact, she became so well known that some of you or your younger siblings might have seen her dance in Sesame Street with Cookie Monster, Elmo, and Telly. Miss Farrell's unique appeal wasn't just due to her physical beauty or technical skill. Mr. George Balanchine, one of this century's greatest dancing masters, was completely captivated by her musicality and her willingness to work very hard and take risks. He created many ballets for her to dance. She, in turn, mesmerized audiences and helped popularize ballet by her devotion to it. Miss Farrell, thank you for that and for being with us today.
Thank you. It's a pleasure to be here. I'm always happy to bring ballet to a new audience and old audiences. It's been a wonderful life for me. It's been good to me, and I'm happy to share it with another generation.
And you are, through the Kennedy Center's education program. You've had a long relationship with them for several years now. And now they've asked you to put this program together, Masters of 20th Century Ballet. How did that come about?
I have a summer course there for national students. And Derek Gordon, the president of the education department, simply invited me to dinner one evening and said, how would you like to get a group of dancers together and go on tour with a small ballet presentation? And of course, I always say yes. And then I sat back and thought about the logistics of putting it together and having auditions and all the kind of things that go into putting a ballet performance together. It all looks very easy, but of course that's why it looks easy, because we do a lot of work behind the scenes.
And I guess the first thing you do is decide which ballets you want to do. How did you determine those?
Again, practical reasons. Sizes of stages have to be taken into consideration. I don't want to see always a mob scene or one person out there. You want to change the configuration of people. I wanted to put together different musical balances, Mozart or Stravinsky or Tchaikovsky, so that, because Balanchine felt that people should see the dance and see the music and hear the dance, and that was his way of working. I also had worked with Jerome Robbins and Maurice Béjart, three great choreographers of this century, and wanted to show a representation of their work.
And how did the final group of them come about, and how did you determine it? Did you know how many dancers you needed? Did that limit you?
I was allowed 16 dancers. I had about 200 ladies, 250 ladies in New York at the audition for only 8 places. And then I also chose men. You have to take into consideration everything. Height of people, because when a ballerina goes on point, she's already 6 inches taller, so you can't have a small boy and only tall women. I wanted to have people with that looked different. Some of the ballets were done especially for me, and I don't look for people who look like me, because that it should be their life, not mine. Mine is over with, now it's their time. And so I was looking for people who wanted to be a part of this project and were willing to change themselves.
Did it, when you talk about changing themselves, you obviously, if you have a big audition with dancers coming from all over, they're going to have different backgrounds of training. And your training is very specifically, well, it was varied in the beginning, but honed into a Balanchine style. What was the gist of the Balanchine way that you had to get across to these dancers? How did you sort of get them thinking in that way?
Well, again, I think one's willingness can overcome a lot of technical obstacles. One of the girls I chose, I hardly noticed her in the audition. I thought her feet were not very good, not quite the right size, not very musical. But then the more the audition went and the more I explained things and asked and taught and asked her to be, you know, this way or that way, suddenly she became so fascinating to me. And she, I took her, and she was one of my stalwart performers. One's willingness can overcome a lot of technical situations. On the other hand, they did have to have a fast technique. Balanchine wanted us to move very, very fast and very, very slow. Sometimes it's difficult to move that way, and you lose it overnight if you don't continue to move fast. But he very much had a specific style of dancing. He took our old view of ballet and created a whole new technique based on American dancers. I was lucky to be a part of that. He loved the energy of America. Balanchine came from Russia. And I think because he fled there during the revolution, and ballet was so good to him and gave him a life, that's why he devoted his whole life to it. And the first ballet he did when he left Russia was Apollo.
And we will see that in a few minutes, a clip from it anyway. When you talk about Balanchine feeling it's important to move very, very fast or very, very slow, why was that so important? Did it have more to do with a sort of a resistance to a pretty ballet, a tutu ballet sort of way of looking at dancing, or was it more an expressive response to dancing?
I believe that, first of all, if you move very fast and very slow, it gives you a big world of music to use. You're not confined to just one specific tempo of music or one particular style. And he very much taught, what he taught in the studio was also a philosophy in life. And you go out into the world and have that same kind of philosophy. And if you move very fast and very slow, look how big your world is. If you only move a little slow, a little fast, look how narrow you've made your life. And so it's just dancing to slow music, fast music, and everything in between produces different feelings in your body, different ways of dancing, different ways of behaving. We all have those kind of things. When we get angry, we get fast and agitated. When you get sad, you become slow. And so all those feelings can be portrayed in music of different tempo.
So in Apollo, the segment we're going to see, can you describe how that sort of applies to that particular ballet and give us some historical background of that ballet?
Yes, well, it is based on the Apollo, the mythological character, and the three muses. There are eight muses, as you know, but only three in the ballet, the muse of poetry, the muse of pantomime, and the muse of dance. And they teach him what they need. In the beginning of the ballet, we see his birth and his awkwardness at being a young god, and he learns from these muses, and then the student becomes the teacher, and the teacher becomes the student, and he takes them off into the world on top of Mount Olympus.
And who will be dancing in this segment?
The three muses and Apollo
are
dancing.
So we'll see them all.
Yes.
We'll see them all. How has it changed? It premiered in 1928. How has it changed over the past 72 years?
In the early days of ballet, you couldn't get people to the theater without having a big Cecil B. DeMille production, lots of scenery, lots of costumes. You know, people hadn't yet appreciated ballet for its own movement's sake. They needed a story, and so that's what he did originally. Then as he got older, he learned that you could eliminate scenery, you can eliminate costumes, and he stripped it down to just the bare essentials of the poetry of dance and its own beauty.
Can we take a look at the video clip and see how that comes out?
Thank you. always feel it's such a holy moment, that moment. Can you explain that ending to us somewhat, the significance of going up?
Well, Apollo was the sun god, the sun king, and that's why we have in that one position that you saw where he is there and the three muses are next to him and behind him, the different angles of the legs sort of represents a sunburst. And Balanchine very much just looked around the world and life and used images from real life. Some of these dancers came to me and said, well, how do you do this step? How do you do that step? How do you do this pose? And I said, well, all these images are taken from a sculpture that Mr. Balanchine had seen in some of the museums in Europe when he went. He, as I said, he came from Russia. He escaped Russia and came to Europe and didn't know any language, only knew the language of dance. And so his education was going around to the museums and seeing different things. And a lot of the images in the ballet are based on famous mythological sculptures. Of course, now in the museums, they're missing some of their body parts, but you can tell they have such wonderful movement. So I would tell the dancers, just look at some of the statues, and that's the way you move. A lot of life in those statues.
And the streamlining, I was thinking about how a lot of us have gotten used to ballets that are like the Nutcracker, where there are a lot of steps and turns and jumps and leaps and a lot of sort of show-offy technique. And this seems to be one of the reasons this is so different to our eye. It's, I'd like you to explain a little bit about how it kind of got jazzed up. There are a few moments that he uses hips differently, for example, you know, in the sort of rocking movements. And can you address that a little bit?
Well, like I said, he uses everything in life. He more than any choreographer, really explored every plateau, every level that you could dance on, that you could breathe on. You know, the air up here is different from the air down here. And as a dancer, it's just thrilling to try to defy those laws of gravity. And in a way, I mean, costume ballets are fun. I love it all. But it's easy to masquerade behind a costume, or even if you are a specific character, you can play that character, or you have something, you know, a costume that hides faults and things. But in a ballet like Apollo, I think it's like confession. You're really stripped of everything, and you have to show your devotion to what you are doing. You can't let yourself be seen that you haven't taken class today. It's a daily, all-day kind of work. It's a wonderful life. And then people are different. And then you have to, when you dance with a man or a man dances with a woman, you have to get on the same wavelength. You know, you can't have your own interpretation and he has his own other interpretation. Timing is very important. You can be very strong, can lift weights and things like that. But if your timing is wrong, you can't lift a featherweight of a girl, you know. So all those things are taken into consideration.
Is it harder to learn that kind of dancing? For example, there's that moment where he's doing the chariot, which is actually called, referred to as the chariot, where the muses are pulling him along. Is that a technically difficult thing, even though it seems kind of gestural and natural?
It's not difficult. It's just, first of all, you've already danced for 20 minutes, so everyone's kind of tired, and that's another thing you have to do is disguise your breathing because no one wants to see how difficult it is. But it's not difficult, it's just not a ballet step. We have a vocabulary, it comes from the French. Our terms are in French because Louis XIV, it derived from his courts. And there's a very specific vocabulary of ballet classical steps. But then Mr. Balanchine came along and he had us dance differently. And there are steps that have no names. It just becomes do one of these or some of those.
Here
comes the chariot, you know. And you all know in Ben-Hur there's chariot race and the horses are dragging him around. Well, there was a similar movement in the ballet and we call it a chariot. So it's not that it's difficult, it's just an un-ballet type of movement, and that's what makes it exciting to do also.
So your appreciation of a place for tutu story ballets and this kind of ballet is one that Balanchine fostered as well, because he took from mythology and all different kinds of literature. And one of the clips we'll see today and a live segment that we'll see later is based on Shakespeare. Would you talk a little bit about that ballet, A Midsummer Night's Dream?
Yes, he always was ahead of his public. He had been known for doing ballets with no story, and now he comes along and does Midsummer Night's Dream, which is, of course, a comedy, very complicated story. And this section we have the two sets of lovers, Hermia and Lysander in blue. They're very much in love. Then we have Helena and Demetrius in red. Helena is in love with Demetrius, but Demetrius loves Hermia, and there's all kinds of problems. There is King Oberon from the supernatural world and his mischief maker Puck, who come down to Earth on this one night, this Midsummer Eve, June 23rd, and play all kinds of havoc with them. There is a magic flower that is sprinkled in the eyes of the person who falls asleep, and when they awaken, they fall in love with the first person or thing they see. And it's a lot of fun.
Let's take a look at that clip now.
Thank you.
quite a different kind of feeling you get at the end of that, as opposed to what we saw just previous to this. It's a mess. Were there any parts of this that show something unique to Balanchine's way of doing things, interpreting literature, adapting that story?
Yes, he shocked his public because he had become famous for having non-story ballets, and then he comes and does this ballet. And of course, all through the history of ballet, we do something called pantomime. I know you all know what that's about, because there is current ways of pantomime. And we've all had emotions that we have in this. We've all fallen in love with somebody and they don't return our feelings. We've all been angry, we've all been mad, all these kinds of emotions. But somehow, when you have to do it in front of a public, in front of an audience, you suddenly become, I've never experienced this emotion before. I don't know how to act. And it's always kind of amusing. But all we're doing is showing ourselves in real life, in the ballet, in dance.
And he has a great sense of humor.
There's
a lot of humor in that.
But the timing's very important for all the comedy to come out and all the emphasis on where the story is.
So comedy is just as hard in ballet as it is in...
Comedy is difficult.
It's always hard. Now, from that setup, we come to the segment that we're going to see here live in the studio. Would you set that up for us a little bit?
Yes. Well, it's another part of the forest. This takes place in a forest, and more chaos is going on. And I had done this part when I was very young and didn't quite have the right way of doing it. And so Mr. Balanchine told me to go out and get a cat and find out how I'm supposed to talk to this partner that I'm supposed to be dancing with. And we will see it here today.
Well, it's one thing, you know, to see it on tape, and another thing to see it live. So now you're in for a treat.
Yes. The thing that, another wonderful thing about Balanchine in this ballet is that the whole story is told in the overture. All the characters are introduced, and we see King Oberon and Queen Titania having this confrontation on stage, because she has this beautiful long silk train with flowers and dewdrops in it and diamonds, and a little page attendant carrying it takes up the whole place of the stage. And Oberon is very jealous, and so he demands Titania to give him this page, and she refuses. So in order to get revenge on Titania, he takes this magical flower and sprinkles it in the eyes of Titania while she is sleeping. And you know the results, or you will see the results of that magic flower, and how love is truly blind.
Thank you.
Thank you, Bonnie Pickard, who danced the role of Titania, and Frank Johnson, who danced Bottom in a pas-de-deux from A Midsummer's Night's Dream. You now have an opportunity to ask Ms. Farrell and the dancers questions by calling the number on your screen, 1-800-578-1396. Ms. Farrell, Titania was another special role for you, as you were saying earlier. And so while the dancers are getting ready to answer questions, I'd like you to sort of think back to that cat and find and tell us a little bit more about what you're thinking when you're dancing with a dancer who has a donkey's head on.
Well, first of all, it's such a sweet face. Who wouldn't fall in love with a cute little character like that? But and it certainly looked easy, but you know, it causes all kinds of problems. First of all, poor Frank can't see much out of that head. And your arms, which you are used to having a certain amount of height and grasp, aren't long enough to go over the donkey's ears and things. You know, no two performances are the same. And whenever you work with props, it just becomes, it's an added kind of a dilemma that you have as a dancer, and all kinds of things can go wrong or very right, and it changes your whole interpretation. It's very interesting dancing with props and characters and masks and things like that.
Well, it looks like the dancers are ready to talk, and let's open up the floor to questions. Take questions here from our students. Yes.
Can you explain what you mean by taking risks?
Taking risks. Well, yes. You know, as a dancer, you like to look at yourself in the mirror, and you want to be proficient in what you do, and you have all your technique very solid and things like that. And after a while, it just becomes an opinion of what you want to look like. Some dancers are very conscientious of how they look like, and they rehearse the same way each time. I think that they're rehearsing an opinion of themselves. I prefer to get out on stage and live in the moment, because the past is over with. We don't know what the future has in store for us. All we have is the moment of now, and you just have to be spontaneous to it and responsible in it and find out what can go on in that moment. And sometimes wonderful things happen and sometimes scary things happen. But I tell you, it's a quick way of learning about life when you really give yourself over to it. And then I think instead of having an opinion, you have options. You have many, many options of how you can be on stage. And it's, I've learned all about life in these ballets.
We have another question. Yes?
How long did you dance?
I've been dancing a long time. I started when I was 8. That's a good age for young ladies to start. Men usually start a little later. But you have to do it, as I said, now when you are young, because the body has to be able to learn and get those muscles and the muscle memory. Your body has to be young enough to be flexible. You know, you can go back to school at any age, but you can't go back to dancing after you reach a certain age. And so it's a commitment. It's a very moral commitment to decide at a young age that you're going to give up a lot of other things and devote yourself to ballet. But it's terribly rewarding. It's nice making people happy. And takes you all over the world to different places, and you get to interact with people. And what I like when I was watching Apollo was how wonderful that orderliness is. I know you all like to dance. I like to do your kind of dancing too, but it's not.
Didn't
as
you start out that
it's
way?
It's not as calming. You know, there's something wonderful about the orderliness of ballet, and I think it's just the serenity is wonderful. Anyway, I've been dancing a long time. I don't dance anymore, but I feel like I could, and if I could have danced forever, I would have.
Has anybody got any questions for the dancers? Well, yes?
What makes ballet different from other types of dance?
Maybe Bonnie wants to answer that. Or Frank, or both.
Well.
It does have a different technique, as I said. It has
a very specific. For one thing, you're wearing toe shoes, right?
Very specific. Mm-hmm.
Point shoes and turn out. The legs are rotated outward, which gives a different look.
And that's part of our technique. But it's also very, very structured in a way. And the choreography is, a lot of choreography in ballet is passed on from one dancer to the other, even though we have videos. It's only recently that we had that. And also, a video is just one particular performance. It's not necessarily etched in stone. You know, she was saying about taking risks. Yeah, there's anything can happen in a live performance. There's nothing like life or live performance. I interrupted you.
Oh, no. It also takes a lot of memory to remember everything that you have to do, all the steps and how they're done, and lots of muscle memory and memory up here too, basically.
In putting together this program, we worked on 8 ballets in 3 weeks. That's an incredible amount of time to, you know, it's
incredibly
one thing,
short.
Incredibly short. It's one thing to learn it. It's another thing to actually get it in your body. You know, sometimes you have it in your head, but you have to translate it into the body. It's very, but it's wonderful.
We have a phone call now from Polk County, Florida. And caller, would you please go ahead?
How long did it take you to become what you are today? I mean, as far as your progress.
You know, I could answer that in specific time, or I could answer that in abstract time. You know, as a dancer, you're always growing. It's a process. I think what's wonderful about, no matter how famous you become, how good your reviews are, how much people clap for you, it's humbling and it's wonderful. The next day you go back to class and you start over and you do exactly what the beginners do. You start from right away, the first step we ever did, plié, bending of the legs. And it instead of making me feel, oh, here I am in class again doing the same thing, I felt it was a wonderful way of feeling renewed and looking at it in a different way. And so it's a process. I danced for a long time. I retired in 89. I had a 28-year career, a lot of ballets done for me. I had a great time. But now in this capacity, I'm still growing. So that's an unending question.
And it's one that I'm thinking about in terms of these young dancers sitting with us today. You know, how do you feel about the progress you've made in this program, but also how long it took you to get here?
Well, it's taken all our lives to get to where we are. You know, every day you try to do more, to be better and to learn more, move bigger, have your heels more forward, something. Every day you try to work and improve. So in the general sense, when you dance, it's who you are. It's your whole life. And it's a wonderful way to express that. In terms of this project, Suzanne is an amazing teacher and coach, and I feel like we all made incredible amounts of progress in a really short amount of time.
Is it a different way of working for you?
It was just nice that so incredibly nice that someone met you with as everything they had to give and were always there to help you.
We have a phone call now from Fayetteville, North Carolina. Caller, would you please go ahead?
I was just wondering, how long did it take to make the role in the last dance?
How long did it take to rehearse it?
Yeah.
Well, I said earlier we had 3 weeks to put together 8 ballets, so I think we taught it maybe the second day in a half an hour. And then, you know, what's also interesting, you have to trust the people you're working with. I teach them something, I give them everything I have, and the specifics of the choreography, and then I trust that they're going to go work on it by themselves. Yes, I will also work on it with them, but there's a lot of preparation that they have to do. Even the best teacher in the world can't make you a dancer. You have to put it in your own body. It's very much a personal, individual thing. And so when you make progress, you say, hey, I made this happen. And it's a wonderful way about learning about yourself. I think we all learned about who we are through dancing. But it certainly is not something you can do for a hobby.
It's a full-time job. Audience, studio audience, other questions? Yes.
What if you take ballet for a long time, but you decide you don't like it or you don't want to do it anymore? Is all that work wasted?
Oh, it's never wasted. I have a niece who studied ballet for a while, and she didn't know how she was going to tell Aunt Susie, I don't want to be a dancer, you know, and she came, you know, and I said, oh, I understand that, you know, you maybe don't want to be a dancer. I think you know, she achieved the level that she wanted to. She was on stage with me. We had a great time together. And it gives you grace. It gives you poise. It gives you what else I like about the ballet, and what I miss not being a dancer now, is that for that hour and a half that you would go to the studio and work, you would tell your legs or your arms what to do, and they would do it. It doesn't really matter how good you are. It's that you have some kind of control over your life. There are so many things in life that are variables, and we have nothing to say about. You know, we just sort of have to go along with the world. And when you're in a ballet studio and you demand of yourself to do things, you do it. And that act of trying is, in and of itself, success. So go back to class. I'll go with you.
We have another phone call from Fort Wayne, Texas. Please go ahead, caller.
From Fort Wayne, Texas. I was just wondering, when did each of you guys start dancing?
I guess this is addressed to the dancers. When did you start dancing?
Well, I started ballet when I was 14, but I started taking other dances when I was about, I guess you can say, 12, 13, about. And I did basically everything else before that, singing, acting, all that stuff.
I was 5 when I started taking ballet class.
And you started in a small little town like I did.
In the middle of Ohio.
It's funny how a girl
that
lived
on pom-poms
and a farm would get into ballet, because you probably didn't see much ballet before you made that choice.
And there's another call from Charlottesville, Virginia. We're getting lots of calls. Please go ahead.
I was just wondering, how old is too old to be dancing or to even start learning?
Good question.
Well, I think you have to be honest with yourself and your physique and how you look. It takes a lot of work and training, so you have to remember, and ballet is based on youthfulness and youthful bodies. So you have to realize what you look like, and do you have enough time to start training to become the type of dancer and the most accomplished dancer you want to be. So it's individual, but I think it's such a wonderful way of life that I think everyone should go to the studio and dance. I didn't want to become a ballerina. I wanted to dance, and it's a much different focus. I loved dancing for its own sake and not for what it could make me become.
I think that's a thought we're going to have to end on. We're out of time. Ms. Farrell, it's always a pleasure to talk with you. And I really do appreciate the fact that you spent this time with us today and shared all your knowledge. And I hope all of you enjoyed it too.
I'm sorry we didn't get to all the other questions.
Oh, there are lots of questions out there. It's important to enjoy these opportunities and to ask the questions that are on your mind, and I hope you had a chance to do that. I'd like all of you in the audience to remember that our next live performance will be Wednesday, February 23rd at 11 a.m. Eastern Standard Time, when the Billy Taylor Trio returns with All About Jazz. You can contact the performers by using the email address on the screen, and we'd like to invite you to visit the Kennedy Center and the Prince William Network websites at the addresses also on your screen. There you'll find information on upcoming programs as well as other resources and the registration form to get involved. Thank you very much.
I would have liked to have had your question.